Dear friends, we begin our session titled New Regional Policy. Indeed, a presidential decree on the basics of the regional governmental policy is being prepared, this draft decree. Today we can still debate on that, and shortly it's going to be decided upon by the presidential decision and decree. We all feel an acute need for change in regional policies so that it could more efficiently prop up the economic growth, and we believe that the regions can contribute to the living standards and the growth rates. And today I believe we should talk about more independence of regions to resolve regional issues, and I'd like to specially mention the level of cities and agglomerations, because these today are the centers of development. And today different types of resources, human, financial and others, pile up there, and the cities are therefore a special environment for development, and they lend a helping hand to more depressed regions and to the rural area. And the statistics have shown that the more people go to the cities, the greater their labor productivity is. So the question is how we should raise the pace of economic growth. So we should start, I believe, with urban areas and agglomerations, and then expand to other territories. We have quite a high-profile panel today. First of all, President of the Republic of Tatarstan, Mr. Minnikhanov. Then Victor Tolokonsky, governor of the Krasnoyarsk territory. Madam Svetlana Orlova, governor of the Vladimir region. Mr. Morozov from the Ulyanovsk region, acting governor of Kaliningrad region. Mr. Alikhanov, governor of Kaluga. Mr. Artamonov. And I will introduce three experts of ours. First of all, Deputy Minister of Economic Development, Mr. Tsybulsky, seated here, and Head of Spatial Development Direction, Center for Strategic Development, Mr. Prazdnichnykh, and Minister of the Government of Moscow, Head of Economic Policies and Development Department, Mr. Reshetnikov Maxim. He is joining us shortly. Well, I made a pause at the outset because we have some technical and logistical obstacles with respect to moving around this floor, but I hope now it's not any more restricted, and everybody who wanted is attending. We have questions that are on our website, and I'll make specific points. And the first round would be quite point blank whether the current power distribution system provides enough stimulus for the regional and urban development, and what our governors and experts believe should be changed in the upcoming 3 to 4 years. Well, the panel of mine is indeed very prominent, and each of the governors have presented their responses not only in words but in deeds, because they run their respective regions. But first let me yield to one of the most active governors, that has been able to raise the maximum amount of foreign investment, Mr. Artamonov. And the other day he issued an article, presented an article to the Russian Gazeta answering similar and related questions. So please be confined to 5 or 6 minutes, and then we will continue. Thank you, Mr. Kudrin. I can't but mention the fact that regional policies are not stark. They are in a flux. And at times, we're satisfied over the progress we've made. At other times, we resent what has been done, because the results may be worse than we expected, like the monetization of benefits. But if we speak, by and large, bearing in mind that the outcome of the Russian Federation hinges to a great extent on whether the regions are successful, in this case, we should primarily speak about whether there is interest among the regions to develop. Referring to each specific region, they should develop their own economies and attract investments and expand the taxation base and be able to sort out the welfare and social issues, developing engineering and social infrastructures, as well as transport one, enhancing their capabilities. It's my firm belief that the regions should constantly be motivated, and we should be certain that once you do something, once you create something, some added value, you'll have additional scope to resolve different goals and tasks, depending on the level of the budget appropriations. I want to say that over the past years, in this domain, the policies of this country have changed considerably for the better. That is noted by foreign investors coming here and reflected in ratings, despite the hardline external political context. The country or sovereign ratings are sustainable, and prior to this moment they were upped on many occasions. Unlike the late 1990s, early 2000s, now the business community sees that the environment in this country is becoming commensurate, comparable, or even more comfortable than those that entrepreneurs see abroad, either in countries of their origin or in countries where they've been around for long. As regards the regions, have they become more interested in attracting investors and developing their own territories, advancing their economies and improving the taxation collection? In this respect, I want to say yes, but probably was not on purpose, but the policies that are built upon the regulations and acts and by-acts and by-laws and the decrees of finance ministry is destimulating, fortunately, and it's quite pronounced, and by my off-hand experience, by my first-hand experience, I want to say that, God forbid, you have the growth in fiscal revenues at home in your regions and exceed the threshold. Like, for example, we had 1.8 thousand parts. You'll be booted out of all the stimulus and support programs. And you'll have to invest considerably in the federal targeted programs. You'll have to co-invest together with the federal government. And what is the soaring rate? So you must, yes, we must invest much more. Like prior to exceeding the cap, you could provide 5% of your budget for funding, and 95% was appropriated by the federal budget, and all of a sudden it turns upwards. 95% is your share, and 5% only will be the share of the federal budget, and this will be quite a prohibitive measure, and you, in this case, will reject any participation in these programs. You'll drop them. And for your case, it is now it's 30-70 ratio. 70% is what we invest, and 30% is put up from the federal budget. In some programs, it's 52% on us, and 48% falls on the federal budget, and depending on the ministry and agency in charge. Why I've been saying all that? I believe it's all quite wrong. The first thing that should have happened is as follows. If a region is able to attract investments and develop their economy, one should at the outset come to terms. Because, you know, the federal funds were not involved, because the regions invested their own money to create infrastructure and attract investors. And so the interest of the loans that were borrowed should be reflected in their spending, in their liabilities. Let me cite my first-hand example. 272 billion was received by the federal budget, and 39 billion rubles was received by the national budget. I'm sorry to cut you, to interrupt you. I'm coming to an end. So we should look at that from this perspective. Otherwise, starting with the year 2000, we have 7 regions fewer now. And like the Kaluga region got in the top league and was kicked immediately by the government. But this is a wrong thing to do. One should stimulate regions so that they become donor constituent entities. Another question as a follow-up. What competences or powers you'd like to see devolved to the regional level? I believe this is a secondary question. But with respect to the powers, there are some issues that are obvious for each and every region. So it should be bottom-up, not top-down management. Like we have especially protected reserve or territory, and the decision to lend it this status is taken at the municipal level, but if you decide to lay down a pipeline across this territory, it should go to Moscow, to the federal ministry. Same refers to the lands out of use, not in use. Why should we wait for the federal inspectors to come and to provide a certificate that the land is used in an unintended way? We have only 9 inspectors for our region, and it will take them 60 years to walk all these fields. Unfortunately, today, all these are federal-level powers, and with respect to the poisoning in Irkutsk, back then, we decided that these, you know, alkalites, hawthorn alkalites should be sold by prescription, but that was cancelled, and now in the State Duma they have draft law that it should finally be sold by prescription. But that was obvious for us at the regional level, and there one can cite much more examples of powers devolved to the regional level. So we'll have better and greater order. We don't need this scope that would entail some political effects or constitutional developments. We need just the routine things, like defining a fine for parking in an unintended area. And these fines may be different for different streets, but why should it be decided in Moscow? Yeah, thank you. I'm not over with you. I'm not through with you. I'll come back to you later. We have here people from the Strategic Solutions Center that jot down all you've been saying, and we have been doing our utmost to streamline regional policies, to provide for a new impetus for the regional development. And now I'd like to yield to Mr. Minnikhanov, asking him the same question. What incentives and stimulus are needed in terms of power distribution and devolution so that you can do much more in your region? You are known to be able to use all the resources, regional and federal alike, so that you can enhance your capabilities in your region, in your republic. What is your view? I probably will support my older counterpart. We are also a donor region, and I spoke recently on that. Not everybody liked it, but I upheld my region's interests, and we should be motivated, all of us, to sort out formidable tasks and goals. And for that, you should mobilize all the people on your soil. To run a territory, you should have proper HR management and manpower management, and you should have funds. I wanted to tell you that it's of importance to stop this subdivision into federal, regional and municipal levels. Like the rank and file people, common people, they don't care what the level is. They just see the government, no matter whether it's a federal or regional or any other level. If the president is trusted and trusts his governors and heads of regions, well, the powers of these should be sufficient. And different appointments and other things they should coincide in one and the same person. So regions should be trusted better. Second, municipalities should actively participate to see progress. I believe that municipalities must be motivated to reach some targets or parameters. I used to be at the municipal level, and I worked at the and I've been working at the regional level, though I haven't had an exposure to the federal bodies. But still, I believe that our regions are the backbone of the Russian Federation. Strong regions will ensure a robust country. How can we change our country unless we improve life in regions? In all the region recent developments mentioned by my counterpart. Well, we will have to be confined in some programs, and as a result of 2016, we had 2.5% growth in our gross regional product, and the industrial output is 103%, and fixed investment is on the rise. But these should be our daily routine, relentless practices. And money shouldn't be withdrawn from regions by the federal center. And that involves a number of new schools, or like building a new roads that will be sufficient to build new roads. I am aware that we are now in dire straits and difficult circumstances, and decisions must be made, but these should be well-balanced ones. And we could find common ground on how to resolve. You mean like centralizing 1% of the withholding tax? I'm referring to MET. And also to 2.8% of the excise of the oil and refined products. And this is on top of the co-funding. In this respect, it's clear why the federal authorities decided in this vein, because some of the regions are in a worse position than others, and they need some backup, and centralization therefore was decided upon. So you believe the federal authorities should have sought a different path? I'm not against helping those regions in need. They probably need even more support, but that shouldn't be at the expense of us. Like Tatarstan has spent a lot and borrowed a lot to carry out the students' games in the past, and we have covenants, and the debt burden and the interest is high, and still we have the obligation to redeem the debt. And the federal center, they subsidize the constituent entities to the tune of 1.5 trillion rubles per annum, and out of these, one-third, approximately, are dotations to fix out the books. And the sectoral subsidies are there also.
And the funds that have to be co-funded, around 350 billion. Apart from that, there are other transfers. They are used today to adjust the sum, and there are also subventions, target subsidies. Well, should these redistributed subsidies be somewhat reduced, then that would probably be the best approach, because the federal budget is also decreasing its expenditure. Probably we should give some thought to getting more money for the federal budget. We should probably reorient our economy towards more growth. The world prices have dropped, and the federal budget has seen a reduction in its revenues worth 3 billion rubles. Certainly additional 3 billion is and cannot be just found in the middle of nowhere. So if we do not want to talk about the centralization of taxation there, we should find some other sources of aid. Colleagues, let's follow up. I'd like to ask about the stimuli and the required powers which are needed for the development of regions. I'd like to ask this question of Viktor Tolokonsky. Colleagues, Mr. Kudrin, to be honest, talking about the powers and their distribution between the federal center and the regions has a permanent one, and we've talked about that forever. We are going to continue talking about that. So let me be very brief. I think the regional entities of Russia have enough powers to develop their economy, their productivity, and this is what we are witnessing the regions are developing, as well as the cities, especially the large cities. They follow this trend, they are developing. We are more concerned by the issue of developing small towns and the rural areas, because some engines of growth have been lost there. Let me be brief. I'd like to express some priorities. First, the legislation we've got is not tailored to the development. It's more tailored to stabilize the situation and to maintain it, to uphold it, and the current state. It keeps the processes going, but it doesn't motivate us, doesn't push us towards development. So in order to implement a project, we are not so much asking or searching for money. We are more fighting with the obstacles we've established for ourselves, such as sorting out some legal issues. So we spend enormous efforts to overcome barriers which can easily be lifted. Secondly, I know that you would probably not agree with that. We talked about that 10 years ago, we still do today. I am confident that the current development, the high technology development, implies a very important role the state budget is supposed to play. But the role of public budget objectively has decreased. Indeed, important sources of revenue have been lost, but let's be honest, over the recent years, we've not been serious about renovating some traditions, customs, rules, and laws that would help strengthen our budget. I'm confident there are great additional potentials. We can make profits, turn it into an investment resource. Right now, they're underused. Some have been transferred offshore. Others are used, but not for the sake of our country. And these profits are not seen as a serious investment resource. We've got a great gray area, great sector shade economy. I think it's 20 to 25%, which is a great potential for the municipalities, for the regions of Russia. And in this context, I think instruments can be devised which are not going to be either time-consuming or money-consuming, and that can help regions, both weak and strong ones. Third, my colleagues mentioned that, and I'm going to join them in saying that we have been acting for development. There are no stimuli, however. There is no correlation. The same thing goes for what we're seeing. We always say, colleagues, is there anything we risk if we exchange to a certain extent profits and the VAT revenues? Well, statistically, is the swap going to be so great? Take 8% of our profit taxes and give as 1 or 2% of VAT. I will never get much from the profits in the high technological sector. We used to get more thanks to income taxes, but right now all has been automated. New technologies do not require many manual hands. Only VAT is a potential source of revenue. Moreover, I'm confident that if revenues were to suddenly increase, there would be new ways of addressing the current issues the federal government is facing. This stimulus has to be introduced. Otherwise, we are going to lose, and lose greatly. Yet another thing. On the one hand, I understand what my colleagues say. Otherwise, I held no grudge against the federal government that we have only 1% of profit. I do understand that many regions have greater problems. What's the balance of your region? 4 billion. 4 billion rubles of revenue, which we lose, and 3 billion we lose on the transportation fund, the excise taxes. Well, Esbon all changed. We have to find additional 3 billion so that our transportation infrastructure doesn't lose. But this is not what I'm talking about. I do understand that a great country has to have a single social standard. Some regions even do not have resources for development, but we've got to bear in mind, to understand, that we're not creating a social level playing field. We are hampering the development. In Krasnoyarsk region, these 7 billion has been used to invest, whereas in other regions, this money is used for the current functioning. It's important, but it also means that the investment potential is being hindered. Viktor Alexandrovich, as far as I understand, you believe the goal is to improve the inter-budgetary relations. Yes, I would start with introducing some adjustments to our taxation regulations. Given the federative character of Russia, I believe regions have to have more opportunities. There should be specific federal taxes and local taxes, but as far as the main taxes are concerned, we've got to have some cooperation in that regard. I remember in the 1990s, I was back then a mayor of a large city. If we had had no taxes back then, Mr. Kudrin, we would not have survived. We used back then all the taxes at our disposal. We didn't have a special taxation service. Right now, we've got some problems with administration. And the 1990s, back then, it was a catastrophe not to pay the tax. Right now, it's not so important. The most important thing right now is to pay the salary, the wages, whereas the taxes as just a second-rate priority. Mr. Tolokonsky, I remember when the VAT was going to a certain extent to the budget of the Russian Federation and to the regions, but let me remind you why we abandoned these model. The VAT is not just calculated, is also offset. So we had several regions which didn't have any profits. So they got some money, but they paid back some money. It all depends on the production mix, on what you manufacture, on whether you export these products or you import them. So some regions get money. Others have to offset for that. They have to make up for that. So there is this difference between what you pay, what you get. Mr. Kudrin, I'm afraid I have to disagree. I lived during that time too, and we worked together. The time when part of that was going to us, it was 20%. Yes, 20%. I forgot. So back then, I always had to make sure that there was no foul play involved, that supervision was very tight. Right now, when I get nothing, I'm indifferent to what's happening. I see what they are doing, but I've got no interest in preventing them from being involved in this foul play. Yes, last year, a new system for accounting for VAT was introduced, and I think everyone is going to agree right now these deficiencies have been overcome. So having now any attempts at not paying VAT or not compensating for it is going to lead to penal prosecution. This is not what I'm talking about. I'm just talking about the very nature of this tax, when it has to be made up for. But that is what you've first said. Developing a large economy requires input from regions. We can no longer use large state-run enterprises like Gazprom or Rosneft to sustain a very high pace of growth. We can only uphold these growth rates if we stimulate each and every industry, each and every company, each and every economic sector. Thank you, Viktor Alexandrovich. We've got yet another governor who represents one of the most prominent, most leading regions thanks to the reform that have been implemented. Sergey Morozov, I'd like to give the floor to you. Mr. Morozov, what do you think the stimuli for development are and what the powers should be? Thank you very much, Mr. Kudrin. I'd like to once again be quite upfront with the issues we are facing. The current distribution of powers, I do not think the current powers help us. I'm not going to cite new examples because enough have been cited by my colleagues, but the aforementioned 1% exemption of profit tax, well, that would signify a lot for us. That would signify 500 million rubles. So in accordance with the federal regulations, we're going to, well, we are not going to get enough. 4 million or so, 4 billion rubles is going to be lost for us. And for us, it's a great loss. What are the proposals we have come up with? Let's remember that we are a federation and the powers of the regions are set forth in the constitution and a number of federal laws that regulate what the municipalities can do as well as the regional authorities can do. We need more trust. We need more confidence as far as the powers go. I'd like to request that your center should pay attention to the transfer of powers related to property and land. A lot of property, a lot of land is not just functioning. It is not contributing to development. I can cite a whale of examples. I think other regions of the Russian Federation also have examples of inefficient use of land or property. I refer to companies in the federal ownership since the USSR. These companies are just barely surviving. They're not making any profits. Their activities have been all but suspended, even though there are potential investors that can help breathe new life into them. I can cite an example when I resorted to Vice Prime Minister, even though we were saber-rattling. The problem was not addressed. Well, we didn't get any result. Secondly, I think many supervisory powers can be transferred, can be devolved to the regional level. Third, I think it's high time we thought about transferring most of federal authorities that work in the regions to the regional level. This is not only going to reduce the costs of the federal authorities, this is also going to increase our all-state cohesion, so to speak. There are a great many other examples like that. I've got a great department of land relations, and the same department of Rosimushestvo exists right on the other side of the road. So these departments do the same thing. And to be honest, we have spent so many years to abandon or to relieve these departments of Rosimushestvo. And the new head of this department says that the previous one has all but destroyed the department. So this is not probably about the powers. This is about the human personnel. I do not think that any federal official is going to go to some distant Kolkhoz or distant farm to look into how the land is being used and why it's not being efficient. I am appointed by decree of the Russian president, so it doesn't mean I have no trust. So what powers are we talking about? The powers with regard to land or... Well, let's take the rural areas. We've got many enterprises, many companies, many land plots that host former federal enterprises. Federal enterprises. That's what you're talking about. Yes. And there are many towns right around them. And because these federal enterprises are not efficient, many people living around do not have jobs. And people do not understand why the government cannot do anything. They do not differentiate between federal authorities and regional authorities. They can only fail to understand why nothing is being done. I think it's high time we revisited the federal legislation related to the activities of the regional authorities and the municipal authorities. Federal law 131, many powers are set forth, but many of these powers are not funded. And new requirements are being leveled against regional authorities. If we revisit the legislation, this is probably going to give us a chance to address the long protracted issue of agglomeration. I told you already that we've got this pseudo-system when the post-Soviet system, the current system, still exists. We've got municipal towns and events with a population of 9,000 people. They have management of their own, officials of their own, bureaucrats. We've got several municipal entities which host 50,000 people or so, and they all have a special authority of their own. We suggest that an agglomeration should be created so that they can create a cohesive policy. So it's going to be coordinate what the authorities are doing. It's going to relieve the federal ministries of the powers they're not supposed to perform, of the functions they're not supposed to implement. Sometimes it's just ludicrous when federal ministries look into greening towns or cleaning the litter. It's good that we get money for that right now. But these are not the powers that should be vested in the federal ministries. The Constitution proves that as well. So if we redistribute these powers, then we will be able to get serious about investment. As was mentioned today, 2 years ago, the country decided to designate the innovative clusters. There are 25 clusters like that. It was announced back then that they're going to be the engines of growth for the regions, but no money was allocated. Last year, this number was slashed to 10 clusters. And it was once again stated that they would serve as the engine. If you look at the federal budget for this year, you'll see that there is no money. Thank you, Mr. Morozov. You've been quite clear with your proposals as to what the redistribution of power should look like. Right now, I'd like to give the floor to you, Ms. Orlova. What do you think the stimuli should be? All the regions that are represented here today in this panel discussion are very different. Some are donors. Others receive money from the federal budget, some are industrialized, others are more into agriculture. What is your region like, madam? And what additional stimuli do you think should be introduced? I'd like to remind you that 7 to 8 years ago, when you were finance minister and vice prime minister, you said that everything should be consolidated at the federal level, outer space and all that, stability in the country was achieved. But I'm very glad that today we're talking about how we should pursue the regional development. Let me remind you that we've ratified the European Charter. We've got to stick by the principle of subsidiarity, which is a very important principle in my view, and we've got to have a different view at what we see. We are not an oil region nor a gas region. And we expect 20 billion rubles of investment over 3 years, new projects. First, I think the taxation system should be best left alone. We've got to first become stronger. We're very glad that regional development policy, regional policy is going to be developed, and that a cushion of safety is going to be created. No one could have expected that the car making industry would just collapse when the crisis struck, the pharmaceuticals and all that. I think right now we should take a balanced approach to what we should do. First, the powers. I agree with my colleagues. The land relations, the property, the number of federal officials, all that should be reduced. We should not be afraid to do that. I can say that we are within the limit as far as our officials go, but I think everything related to environment, to natural resources, that requires a very, very careful look. There are instances when we cannot get to the federal level, and there are issues that we have to address in an instant, like litters and waste management. It requires technologies. It requires the establishment of new industries. It can help us create new electricity. Another matter, which is of great import. Let's look at import substitution. We cannot but take that into account right now. Let me cite the example of our region. We've got a new company with cutting-edge technologies. This is a pharmaceutical company. It creates drugs against tuberculosis and hemophilia and many other types of illnesses. They have manufactured new products, and some official in the healthcare ministry has taken a decision and no drugs are being purchased from this company. So if we continue in this way, if the federal level is not helpful, if it decides against supporting our companies, it's going to be a disaster. The ministry, the region has been efficient. The federal level hasn't been so. Another matter, cooperation between the federal level and the regional level. It is now being developed, and that's very good. Another aspect, our corporations. On the one hand, it's very good probably that a crisis has happened because we've learned a lot. Corporations have gone to the regions with R&D, with new technologies. Probably I do not need your money from the federal budget. Just leave me alone. Let me do my job. Do not try imposing things on me. Well, the excise taxes, the VAT, yes, I agree with you. If you take money and give money to those who do not have it, well, you should better think about how you can make it up to the regions that have lost. For me, that is good money, like 1.3 million rubles that has been taken from my region, at which I can turn into 3 billion, using it to invest into innovations and pharmaceuticals. We've got to have a very careful look at the powers. Revisit the subsidiarity principle. Now, getting back to agglomerations, we're not going to get far should we fail to create good environments. By the way, we had a very good clean water program. We've got to get back to the fundamentals which regions require. Without a smart city, no young people are going to stay there. If there is no Wi-Fi, no cinemas, no bicycle tracks, if there is no pedestrian area where I can go to and have some rest. People go all around the world. They see that in other countries. Why is the current trend creating these agglomerations, smart cities and strong regions? Let's have a look. Apart from the budget, there are other instruments that can help regions develop and advance, like the infrastructure. Let me cite an example. For 16 years, we've been unable to create a highway, road. Finally, we've been successful, thanks to the president's support, and it has helped relieve the pressure from the urban area. These are good projects. They should get attention they deserve. So I think these matters require a very close look. I think this is the right approach. Thank you, Svetlana. We are going to get back to what you said, since Anatoly Dmitrich is going to leave us early. Is there anything you can add to the discussion raised by the other members of the panel? Well, Mr. Kudrin, everyone is so experienced here. I join what has been mentioned today. The only thing I'd like to add, and what I mentioned earlier, just to sum up, we've got to have a close look at the regions that are developing, that manage to find opportunities for development. They should get the assistance. They should get the stimulus. And once they have reached the point of self-sufficiency, they shouldn't face blows. They shouldn't face harsher rules right away. They shouldn't get these regions. We have regions like that, but they should get subsidies just for a little longer. Their ratios should be maintained at the same level, and then they will have a time to adapt. They will understand how good it is to develop, to advance. And the corridors, I'm being approached very often, and I'm asked, they're saying, yes, you're in for it, you're in for trouble. This is a very dangerous reaction to development. Let me ask you a very sensitive issue. Right now, the panel here is comprised of governors that have achieved a lot. Do you think there are many regions whose governors, even if vested with the necessary powers, are going to be unable to achieve results? Right now, the governors, on the whole, are comprised of leaders who know what they are doing and who want to do something. We should understand that this is a large country, and Russia. We cannot use one and the same model to manage this or that region. Each and every region requires a tailored, a bespoke model, something special which is going to help it. Some regions should develop fishing industries, and it can turn out to be profitable. Other regions, like Chornozem regions, should develop agriculture. Some regions should pursue high technologies, others timber industries. In each and every case, we should find this component which is going to help to raise the taxation base, and they should not be punished for that. That is the crux of the matter. Thank you.
Well, now you must be off. Thank you. And we also have a question to Mr. Alikhanov from the Kaliningrad region. How would you support the very same question on stimulus and incentives? Thank you, Mr. Kudrin. Unfortunately, Mr. Sobyanin, Mayor of Moscow, is not with us today. But as far as I understand, this 1% originates, you know, from the idea of finance ministry to take money from Moscow that had more than 100 billion rubles piled up at its accounts. But anyway, they decided to treat everybody equally. Kaliningrad suffered a lot. We are a donor region. We, thanks to the customs zone, pay a lot of VAT. But our law on special economic zone has only has a very low investment threshold, like 50 million rubles invested for the course of 3 years. So it's quite a bizarre situation. The special treatment is not there, although it should be. And we, because of the decisions at the federal level, we lost around ₹1 billion. I don't get anything from the VAT revenues we have, and we haven't seen any tax revenues, and I don't have any proprietary resource of my own. Now, with respect to what Mr. Artamonov said, that like it's of no interest to look closely into taxation schemes. But ours is a different path. We have a stimulus system for municipalities. We help them repay transport tax indebtedness. Because on the ground, heads of municipalities can interact with road police and with bailiffs in order to raise the collection levels and collection rates of taxes. And to preclude that, we provide special appropriations for them to their municipalities. There are several other interesting and intricate points, typical of Kaliningrad specifically. With respect to powers, Kaliningrad has a lot of benefits, but unfortunately a huge amount, and a lion's share of those, is offset by the fact that if, for example, an entrepreneur manufactures a good and delivers it to Russia via Belarus and Lithuania, the shipment is checked and rechecked, and in transit, it's well, the shipments are constantly checked and inspected, and this is a destructive influence for the economy of the Kaliningrad region, and we believe that despite there is special legislation on the special economic zone in Kaliningrad, and now amendments are coming, my respect to the economic ministry. But anyway, we'd like to have more powers on the regional level. At our level, we have consolidated all the powers with respect to oversight and supervision in one and the same ministry, and we won't have any extra inspections without the authorization of a deputy governor. And there is one issue I'd like to touch upon, which is the excessive interregional competition. If we ask all those governors around, well, on the panel, all of them will cite pharma industry as one of their priorities. Well, yes, Kaluga, Tatarstan and other regions indeed have this. But huge money is invested by the federal government into the pharma industry. So new regions start establishing production sites without special training or skills or track record. And therefore they duplicate the manufacturing sites of regions with considerable track record. And so some industries we may have different schemes, but we with us, for example, in Kaliningrad, we want to localize the production of catheters. And we have attracted a Korean investor. And everybody, all the governors definitely would try to provide benefits. But there is no preferences in the federal system, like if you invest in this type of product, you receive this subsidy. And we have a free hand in government in public procurement. It's not governed by the WTO provisions and rules. Unfortunately, international investors are not always aware of the rules of ours, and as these seem intransparent, and probably we should create a set of transparent rules, all that make the regions eligible to mount their own barriers. And let me now move to experts and ask Mr. Prazdnichnykh. Like, from the perspective of global trends, modern trends, do our regions fit into the global trends? Different regions with great efficiency rises. Do we use all the instruments available? Thank you. Just a few comments. One on my first point on how regions have been developing, second on what state-of-the-art regional policies in different countries are. As regions are concerned, over the past 20 years, the gaps between the most developed and the least developed regions globally have been widening. All attempts to reduce these gaps or narrow them were not fulfilled. Second, from the year 2000 to the year 2005, there was another overhaul globally. The differences between regions of one and the same country are now much greater than differences between different countries. So, which means that now you don't need to visit the United States first or then go to Africa, just visit different states within the US. And the experience of the past 20 years shows that attempts to narrow the regional development gaps have failed. In this country, we also tried to reduce the differences, and that strategy was not implemented. If we look at the most and least developed regions over the 7 years, the situation remained the same. The most developed regions are 7 times as rich as the least developed ones. And if we look at the OECD countries, Russia ranks second to Mexico only with respect to the scale of these gaps. And we rank number one globally with respect to the life expectancy differences and income bracket differences. Like, we have 17 years of difference in terms of life expectancy between the most and the least developed regions. So, unfortunately, the regional development is not a fair play. The most developed regions have the swiftest pace, and it's the same worldwide as regards regional policies. 20 to 30 years ago, the main idea in advanced economies was to reduce the differences between regions and, like, stimulating the least developed and creating infrastructures for them, stimulating services, fortunately now the understanding is there that it ain't beneficent like 5 years ago. We debated in here about whether we needed some leveling or something else. Well, I believe we need a balanced policies, and the regional policy in this country should contribute to stimulating and boosting economic demand, economic growth, pardon me. For that we need a flow of investments and the development of human capital, and now we arrive at an understanding that the regional policy is a driver of economic development. If we look at the regions and return of investment in different regions, we see great differences. So, to step up economic growth in Russia, we should invest into developed regions. Unfortunately, there are no silver bullets or easy solutions. The new regional policy should be that of different opportunities. Each region has its own problems, and 90% of regions will not yield the desired results because they lag behind, and for them we should first raise the human resources quality and improve manpower. What we need is smart specialization. May I reinterpret your words? Probably I'm wrong. You've been saying that each region should have its own path of development. And for one region, you may see a giant leap forward, and for other region, you will not. True. Let me cite a radical example. It's no use artificially sporting a high level of inhabitants in a region, like when people move from one region to a different one, like the region that people fled starts seeing greater labor productivity. So we should reduce barriers for regional migrations. It's important so that people can choose regions what they need, what they want, to their liking. So in other words, if we can't reduce the difference in regional development, we should regard it as okay, so that people may move from one region to another, and we are to reduce the barriers for their migration so that some people may find new opportunities in new regions. Yes, sure. And these regions that people leave may become richer and more efficient in the course of time. Well, probably the best people flee or leave. Well, unfortunately, ...20% of regions get 80% of results with respect to labor productivity and investments. And it's of importance to say, colleagues, that differences between regions are high because the leaders, leading regions, stop developing. Now everybody should struggle for investments. Yes, thank you, Mr. Aleksey. Probably I'll yield to you at the end for the final remarks. Well, anyway, it's in line with the approaches of the governors. Like, they are against the egalitarianism and the equaling of all. And I'd like to yield now to Mr. Tsybulsky, Deputy Minister of Economic Development, to ask him about this draft decree of the President that is now being fledged, and whether we can provide more independence and sovereignty to regions, and what should be done by the federal authorities. Thank you, Minister, and today I prepared a special comments with respect to that draft decree, but the course of the debate, could you please move on stage and sit? That makes my goal easier, because I know more the opponent of the governors. I'm part of them now. You're one of the, well, you're probably the only high-level federal. Well, but don't, never say never. You may one day become governor. I'm an official. You know, before people are appointed ministers, I would make them governors so that they have more skills and know the ropes. As an ex-minister, I can say the experience of 4 years of first vice governor of St. Petersburg allowed me to be able to have better understanding. Well, St. Petersburg is a prominent region, you know. You started building roads there, like the high-speed diameter, and 300 million was invested. I helped you. Now we know all about it, Mr. Kudrin. I'll try to comment on what Mr. Kudrin has raised. The first is the sovereignty of the regions. I'm convinced that those regions that can deliver on the powers that are devolved to them should have as many powers as they can devour and handle. But unfortunately, we have transferred part of this competences to the regional level without any financial backing. And the Ministry of Justice, well, we have seen the governmental decrees and different bylaws, and this is quite a correct question, but we should be quite careful about this. And all that was initiated by those regions that are presented here on the panel. Unfortunately, the Russian Federation now is different. And Mr. Kudrin compared us to the best OECD countries, but we have our own specificity and we'll need our own patterns. Like today, France's regions are almost the same, alike, but France has a population of only 66 million people, and their territory is smaller than that of Yakutia, with only 1 million of population. Have no one-size-fit-for-all decisions, solutions. Well, we've been facing issues with respect to regional development. And we've been trying to develop regional policies. We have a law as of 1996, but now it has become obsolete, and there is a new generation around And now we are to define new approaches of how to develop our regional policies. Now I'm in the NAM chair of the governor and I can confirm that there are concerns and it's going to be sensitive for regions. Well, nothing. Well, for example, we used to taking this 1% that was taken away from you, but we have in turn provided grants and 20 million of grants will be distributed among the leaders of the rating, innovation rating, and then we'll have corporate profit tax refunds for regions if they develop properly. And it has been about incentivizing, no incentives for regions receiving dotations. They leave off and they sponge on that, and they know that they always will receive money. So there is a concept that dotations and appropriations will be given only if there is an agreement that the regional government guarantee that the situation in the region will not become worse or living standards will not drop. They should maintain the current levels of revenues and other parameters, takeaways. So it's going to be a mutually beneficial agreement, and even poor regions will be able to show results and will be incentivized to get additional money from the federal budgets. Now a couple of words on the new regional policies. Now we have seen a new we've talked about a new draft decree of the president to eliminate constraints and provide for the spatial development of the Russian Federation, and that also has a bearing on the co-funding level. We shall be able to find head or tail of this, and we have the greatest territory in the world, only 9th or 10th largest population. And infrastructural constraints should be removed and handicaps should be eliminated and dismantled. We'll be able to redistribute the resources with the help of the co-funding patterns. And probably, yes, indeed, that should be done with the help of urban areas. We should start with them, and most people in the future will move to the cities, will live in urban areas, and our migration policies, domestic migration policies, matter a lot. People should be able to move from one region to another in search of better conditions and a better job. But mentally, our people don't want to move anywhere. They're accustomed to live in one and the same place. And a generation will pass before people get convinced that they should move to a new region to receive better conditions and living standards. It's not done overnight. And one of the main goals of this regional policies is so that the regions unlock their own inherent and potential. proprietary potential of that. And the fourth is like improving inter-budget relations. There is a long way to go in that domain on how to distribute revenues, taxation revenues. And now the debate is only being launched, and we will actively pursue that in the near future. And we will also be able to come up with a strategy of spatial development of the Russian Federation, which will be a founding underlying document. It's going to be compiled as a holistic strategy for the Russian Federation development, and some of the upbeat experts believe that optimizing the spatial development will give another 1.5% of GDP growth. But these are unofficial figures. May I make several comments? Well, will you please stay where you are seated? Well, several comments on my part first. One could agree with you. 20 billion for grants. Well, we should change the methodology. That would give nothing. Second important issue. Like, the regions are different and will not be able to level conditions everywhere quickly, but we should provide for the autonomy of the regions. We should have a fixed set, permanent set of mechanisms. The corporate profit tax is something we're coming back to. The rate would be different for different regions. But anyway, that will not be a source of rapid development. Look at the Kaliningrad acting governor. He's one of the greenhorns. But anyway, he sees a tie to eye to me with respect to that. We cannot sell our high-end products because the ministries and different agencies, federal agencies, preclude us from that. And we should have the revolution in the regions, in the regional development, and we should have a new law in place of the obsolete one, and we should have all the things analyzed. We should adopt a law on counterfeit items. We've been lacking it for long. And what we need, well, you also need to look into that matter. But please don't compare us to Mexico. We are ahead of them, and we have, you know, thanks to the relocation program, been able to move people out of the ramshackle and dilapidated housing.
Yes, 10 years ago, it was not so. It was even worse than in Mexico. But over this decade, we've done a lot. Please do not forget that right now we have powers with regards to capital renovation. We assumed these powers on our own, and the regions that do that, they do get some bonuses. The energy efficiency is of great importance. Now, the example of France. Take Vladimir. Please, someone of the economy ministry, come to the city of Vladimir and you'll see that it's better than in France there. You don't go there. Well, to be honest, thank you, Svetlana, but officials from the ministry go to the regions. Well, let's be honest, Mr. Kudrin. We shouldn't be afraid to tell the truth. I had only Belikov from the economic ministry, and that was 3 years ago or so. Well, I've been to your region just recently, yes, but you're not from the ministry, Mr. Kudrin. Oh, all right, then, colleagues, let me follow up. We've got some time left. 3 minutes, 3 minutes and a half. We would like to have yet another round of discussion. And what ways are your regions successful, and what do you view as your priorities? Mr. Minnikhanov, you've got this strategy in place for the development of the region, so you set a very important goal of elevating the technological level of your industry, which is a challenge of our times, and oil refinery, which is one of your priorities. The objective is the same. Are you successful in raising this technological level or not? Probably there are other priorities that you've designated. To start with, yes, he is a very good person, but you live harboring illusions. You say 20 billion rubles, but you've taken this money from us. If we work efficiently, then first you'll get 610 million and you take 3 million from me. Even the Constitutional Court always takes a decision saying that we cannot exempt any preferences, we cannot decrease the standard of living. So you take this money, and I understand that I've got to take a decision to offset that. Regions have to be supported, you've got to search for ways to do that, but you cannot simply take so much money, because this is a very huge lump of money, and it's not just about me, it's about 4 million people who live in our Republic of Tatarstan. I am responsible for Tatarstan, and I cannot tell you that. No one likes that, whether you like it or not. I'm going to be vocal about it. So we've got to have a look at what can be done. It was said, well, something about counterfeit alcoholic beverages. This year, 350 ton of illicit beverages with alcoholic contact is being confiscated, but it's very much. But what about the beverages that are not being confiscated, that are not found? These are humongous losses. The federal Parliament takes decisions on the transportation tax, the tax, other tax which are worth 35 billion as a whole. And do I understand correctly that federal preferences have to be transferred to the regions? Yes, please give us these powers so that we are able to make exemptions if any exemptions are needed, because we know better what preferences should be like. As far as I understand, this is a framework legislation, so the federal authorities are willing to take these steps to reduce preferences. Yes, but they should be reduced, but they should not be abandoned altogether. Yes, I've said so much. What we need is a good economy. We need jobs, we need economic growth. Without any dynamics, no project is going to be successful, nothing is going to be implemented. Or that's why I'd like to thank the Ulyanovsky Center. We have come up with the 2030 program, and with regard to each and every municipality, we adopted special programs, specific programs. We've got to care about the human capital, we've got to create a good environment conducive to their development, we've got potential to do that. This year we produced more than 35 million. We count on our potential per se. We have two budgetary cycles, 3 and 3 years, to raise additional 100 billion by 65%. We launched this program in 2015, and we're going to raise additional money. We've got to raise our revenues because there is no other option. We have to find money to introduce innovations in the basic industries and other industries. We need to achieve a higher, a deeper refinery rate, polymetals, aluminum. We do not have internal demand in the country, and that's why there are constraints on the aluminum industry. That's why we create an aluminum valley, a cluster, even grain refinery. We produce 2.5 million tons of grains. We use only 1.2 million of that. The other million has to be exported or refined. As far as the external investment is concerned, we've got a specific position our region as mostly based on large-scale companies. Vankor Neft has now foreign investors, other companies as well. This process is going forward. It's very helpful because it helps us raise our efficiency, raise our profits. The investment process is underway. We set the goal of investment development. Our investment yearly is 400 billion, which is more than 25% of the gross regional project, but our plan is 30% of our gross regional product. This is a task very difficult to achieve. Without foreign investment, we're not going to be able to hit this target. We need to work on food and timber processing because we've got so many forests and related resources, the metal refinery as well. So our task is not just to prove we are attractive from the investment point of view. We have to be socially attractive. Our goals are very high, lofty, but our indubitable priorities are science, technology, education, innovative economy. New generations are not content with the old industries. They require a new development paradigm. That's why we deem it very important to develop the education field, the integration of scientific centers and laboratories. We've done a great job in climbing the investment rating. In the past, we didn't used to pay any attention to that. We had enough money from metallurgical industries, from oil, but right now education is the foundation of the future, and it has to be a priority for each and every region. This has to be stimulated. Thank you, Mr. Tolokonsky. You mentioned so much investment right now. Many in our country believe that investment has been suspended in our country, but your plans are so lofty, so ambitious, mostly related to new industries based on innovation. I'd like to support you, and we're going to follow your success. I have to say that there are difficulties with innovation. We talked about investment during breakfast. Investment is not enough. For Krasnoyarsk region, 400 billion is not good enough. Most of these investments are just to maintain status quo. We've got so many industries which require investment just to keep on going. We need to support the infrastructure, the high voltage lines, the power stations, water reservoirs. These are large scale projects, but they do not exactly reflect the investment level we require. We need investment everywhere. So we do not have yet a very good investment environment. The money is too expensive. We do not stimulate enough demand for what we produce. We do not stimulate our exports enough. There are systemic tasks which we are still facing, which have to be addressed by the government for the investment to grow. Thank you. And right now, I'd like to ask Anton Ulyanov, you've got a special economic zone. Does it yield any results? What do you think the outlook should be for further development? Well, certainly this zone was established in 1992. A special law was adopted in 1996. Then in 2006, we used to be the first in the Russian Federation to pioneer this project. Right now, we've lost this palm of primacy. Many new regimes have been established. They're more attractive, like advanced development regions, which have been put into place. I'd like to express my gratitude to the Ministry for Economic Development and to Alexander Arkadyevich for the great job we've done to prepare the decision adopted on April the 1st, 2016. Many think that preferences have run out in Kaliningrad, but in my estimates, these preferences have become even better. Many subsidies have been allocated, additional preferences on the customs VAT, which are unique for Kaliningrad. I'd like to express my gratitude once again. We understand, however, that we need to go even further. We've got to raise the level. Together with the ministry, we have drafted a number of adjustments to the legislation with regard to e-visas and many other things. We want Kaliningrad to once again become sort of a bridge of our open economy. Just due to our geographic position, we need to live counting on external economic operations. So I like to say that we're going to concentrate on breakthrough dimensions of work. Should we consider compare ourselves to Krasnoyarsk region, we should remember that it was built by the whole Soviet Union, billions and billions of dollars were invested in Krasnoyarsk, whereas Kaliningrad started its development after the Helsinki Act, when it was secured, so to speak. So we need investment in fixed capital for the 10 to 15 years to come. Unfortunately, the 2008 crisis for us has not yet ended. It's only drawing nigh to the end. We were witnessing some negative dynamics, and just last year we had positive dynamics, whereas before the decrease was in the double-digit area. Right now the situation has calmed down a little bit because we addressed many matters in 2016. What we want to do is to create the simple things economy, so to speak. We've been talking about the investment expenditure in Krasnoyarsk, for instance. But what is this money spent on? To stimulate demand. That's what they're doing. But whose demand? If in Kaliningrad we stimulate the consumption, the demand of consumers, we're not going to stimulate the economy, because we do not have an economy of simple things. Over the last 5 years, we have advanced our agriculture, but we've taken a great hit after the sanctions. Luckily, we've got many new investors right now. There is some demand among the population, and it creates a multiplication effect. We are very close to the borders to Poland, to the Baltic states. 35% of our population have never been to other regions of Russia. That's why the preferences is a very sensitive matter to us. We want these adjustments to the legislation to be adopted as soon as possible. On the other hand, we see that our region has a great investment potential. But in what way? The thing is, the influx of people every year is 8,000 to 9,000 people, and that's not bad at all. We have specialists coming to us, highly trained specialists from the north. They are people with money, with experience. We rank second in Russia as far as the number of SMEs per capita is concerned, and that's good. We should continue to create special regional instruments for support. This is going to give us a chance to create a new model of economy. Kaliningrad has always been export-oriented. Regrettably, due to the rubble depreciation, the old model has exhausted itself. We need something new. We are establishing some sort of a treasury, that's what we call it, which helps us collect the federal money. Why is that? Until April the 1st, 2016, Kaliningrad counted on preferences which existed before that. Right now there is a new potential which we see. We need to learn to work with corporations, with federal preferences. We've got to enrich the Kaliningrad region with money. Yes, thank you very much, Svetlana Yurievna. You should remember that your region has a great tourist potential. All world can come to you because these are the cultural treasures of world level we're talking about. But what do you think your priorities should be? What should be the dimensions you are supposed to pursue to go further? Mr. Kudrin, you are absolutely right when saying about tourism, we had to spend a lot of effort. Right now, tourism accounts for 7% instead of 3% of our gross regional product. We organize festivals, we revive handicraft, creating new tourist attractions like a new small city not far from Kovrov, 40 minutes or so, Dobrograd. Yeah, it's a city with a good sports infrastructure. It's been built on private money, a school, a private clinic, and a kindergarten are going to be built there, 200 kilometers of ski tracks. We held a forum of the Sports Russia, and even President Putin was there, and that's just a small city with 140,000 people. So we've broken the stereotype that forums have to be held only in large cities. I'd like to thank everyone, Mr. Shuvalov and President Putin. We've done a lot to develop SMEs and agriculture. We've achieved a self-sufficiency level. We are developing manufacturing and processing industries thanks to the corporations, Mr. Kudrin. In Russia, the investment rate is 9.8. We've got 10.2. The product is worth 430, and 29% of the products we produce are high technology. We are going to continue with the development of agglomerations of private investment, certainly we're going to support SMEs in all its forms and manifestations because it contributes a lot to development. Now, as for transferring to different regions, well, people go to different countries. We've got to remember that. The world is an open place, and we should be fine with that. But there is a matter we've got to emphasize. That's the salaries, the wages. We've done a lot. We took additional money from the funds. Right now, our salary has increased from 19,000 to 24,000 plus. It's not too much. There are regions with 37,000, with 60,000. We've got to work together with the Ministry for Economic Development in this regard, because raising salaries and wages is yet another opportunity for people to remain where they are, to trust the future. We've got project officers, as you know, working together with the RANEPA. And it's the fourth cycle of training sessions for our human resources. And we've also got a project for single industry towns. Trust me, this is how many towns in Russia were built, how they developed, because it creates opportunities for investors. And we've got investors not just from outside. We've got local investors. We have three enterprises, Vladimirsky Standard, Voyage, and a number of investors from outside. So it's kind of a mixture, a combination of investors both from outside and domestic investors. It's very interesting. This program is great, and it contributes a lot to the development. I think the more open we are, the better. The international cooperation has been mentioned here, but first we've got to adopt a law, which we still have not. There are many things we in regions cannot do. For us to be more active, despite the sanctions, we need legislation on international cooperation. That would be of great help to us. On the whole, I think this discussion is very interesting. I'd like to thank you. Thank you, Svetlana Yurievna. And We have with us Mr. Reshetnikov. We cannot but give the floor to Moscow, but you've got just 3 minutes. We had a discussion in your absence about the powers required. It's a second round of discussion. It's up to you what you want to say in those 3 minutes. You can go here and face the audience. Yes, I don't want to stand with my back turned to other regions.
Dear colleagues, thank you for the opportunity to speak. Of late, Moscow has been developing quite actively. And we always hear voices that with such huge billion. And when this was discussed, the idea, a sound idea, was to sign contracts and agree. Like the corporate tax and the individual's income tax and other things can be used to mobilize new revenue. And we could also introduce programs to have more efficient use of funds and targeted subsidies and other things. And Moscow has been quite active in all this, unlike other regions. And the regions are reluctant to borrow our practices. We have communications with donor regions that are doing well, like we've been in contact with Tatarstan and Svetlana, also Moscow region, Bashkortostan, Belgorod region. These are donor regions. What about the rest? Yes, money for efficiency, which should be the principle. But the upper house of our parliament had discussions on that, and the recipient regions say that it's our holy right to receive subsidies. Let's provide us subsidies and we'll do the rest. But as of today, these are key issues. And I'm coming to a close. It's about the strategy. I believe all of us should understand that countries today compete with the help of their major cities. Like, well, we deal with German major companies, and all of them have Tatarstan's and Ulyanovsk presentations in front of them, and we spend a lot of time to explain it, that we are better. And Moscow has a special historic commission, and we are the biggest city, urban area, and we are a magnet for people from the post-Soviet space. But anyway, it's about a question to all the donor regions and recipient regions. Moscow has been adapting to the new normal, and as of 2016, we've started active and rapid development in the upcoming decade. We should bring our discussion to a close, and I'd like to yield to Mr. Tsybulsky a minute and a half for you. So you are in charge of regional policies, and you can hear the voices and you receive the feedback, and we'll continue our talks with you. Thank you. Mr. Kudrin, 30 seconds will be sufficient. All those projects, the framework that defines the regional development. And further on, we'll have to expand the plan of the events. So I agree with the panelists, and let us incorporate some of the feedback of yours into that draft decree. And I'd like to comment, like, I never visited Vladimir region, but on the 20th of January we'll have there the first strategic session on further spatial development strategy. Oh, it's our pleasure to host you. Dear colleagues, today we have a clear understanding and awareness that the regions can add up to our national GDP growth. They have the reserves that are yet to unlock. We should fine-tune, therefore, and tweak our regional policies with respect to scope of powers and inter-budget relations. Making it more transparent. We are aware that we can will not be able to have level conditions for all the regions. Some of them will grow faster, others will grow slower. But anyway, we need a balanced, well thought over approach. And we have jotted down some of the things you mentioned, and we will have more meetings of this format in our next forum in Sochi. We'll see a similar debate, and probably we will come forward with new ideas in February. Then we'll meet in St. Petersburg. After Sochi, then Krasnoyarsk. Please remember about Krasnoyarsk. Afterwards, Kazan and Vladimir, yeah. SPB, as always, and in October we'll have a strategic planning forum between the Economic Development Ministry and other agencies, and I always attend, so October, please pencil that in. And we need, anyway, in the course of the year to elaborate this new policies, to come up with it and present it to the President and incorporate it into the new strategy. So let us work hard and get down to business and to brass tacks. Thank you.